At high speeds, it's essential for the pilot to know his Mach number, and Mach meters are fitted to all high-speed aircraft. What actually happens to the air in the aircraft when approaching the speed of sound? The airflow speeds up as it passes over the wing and reaches the maximum speed at a certain point on the wing. So the Mach number of the air at this point is greater than that of the aircraft as a whole. As the aircraft's speed increases, so does the local Mach number at this point on the wing. Eventually, just at this point on the wing, the air reaches the speed of sound, although the aircraft as a whole is still flying slower than sound. The aircraft's Mach number, when this happens, is called its critical Mach number, usually written M-crit. Soon after this, things can begin to happen. This aircraft is buffeting violently. Aircraft vary in their behavior above the critical Mach number, but until designers overcame them, there were always some adverse effects. They're caused by shock waves. Let's see what this means. If a model wing is put into a high-speed wind tunnel, a special photographic technique known as Schlieren makes visible the places where the pressure of the air changes as it passes round the wing. In this picture, wherever the color is green, the speed and pressure of the air are almost constant. Blue has been chosen to show up the areas where pressure is falling fastest, while red shows where the air is being slowed down and pressure is increasing. Now look at a diagram. At the critical Mach number, the airflow is moving across the wing at this point at exactly the speed of sound, M equals 1. Above the critical Mach number, the point grows into an area in which the flow is faster than sound. M is greater than 1. Everywhere else, the flow is slower than sound. M is less than 1. The rear boundary of this area is formed by a shock wave. As the speed is increased still further, the shock wave grows larger. What causes the shock wave? Think again of the tiny pressure waves radiating out at the speed of sound from every point on the wing. The ones coming from points on the rear part of the wing, such as this one, meet airflow coming the opposite way and make less and less headway until they can't travel any further forward at all, because the airflow itself is moving backwards as fast as they are moving forward at the speed of sound. It's like trying to step off an escalator going the wrong way. The little pressure waves pile up, building into one big pressure wave, the shock wave. And here's the real thing in the wind tunnel. The wing has just passed its critical Mach number, and there's the shock wave, red, because it's a sudden, sharp increase in pressure. But shock waves don't only form on wings. Wherever the air speeds up enough in its passage over the aircraft, on cockpit canopy, fuselage, and stabilizer, there too shock waves will form. The most striking effect of shock waves is a sudden, very sharp increase in the aircraft's drag. This is because the shock wave heats up the air and compresses it. And this absorbs a lot of extra energy, which has to be continuously supplied by the engines. The rate at which the drag increases is itself highest somewhere around Mach 1, although the actual drag goes on growing all the time. This sudden increase in drag above the critical Mach number is what used to be meant by the sound barrier. Most of the other adverse effects of shock waves arise because they cause the airflow to separate from the wing surface. This produces a large wake of turbulent air behind the shock wave, which alters the pressure around the wing. This in turn may cause loss of lift, and some aircraft may lose height. In others, one wing may drop. The aircraft may pitch, or porpoise as it's called, or undergo other weaving movements such as snaking and Dutch roll. The turbulent airflow from behind the shock waves may hit the stabilizer or other parts of the aircraft and cause buffeting. Or the controls may be affected. Here, slowed up about 40 times, is a Schlieren picture of what may happen to an aileron as a result of shock waves. How have aircraft designers overcome these shockwave troubles? One way is to put them off to still higher speeds by actually raising the critical Mach number of an aircraft. The designer does this in two ways. First, by using relatively thin wings, wing sections whose thickness is small compared with their width from front to rear. The thinner the wing, the less the air is speeded up while traveling over it, and so the higher the critical Mach number. The second method is to sweep the wing back. Suppose this unswept wing has a critical Mach number of 0.8. If we sweep the wing back, only that part of the airflow at right angles to the wing is speeded up as it passes over the wing. So the critical Mach number is raised.